Let's start this morning with our declaration. Oh my gosh, everybody ready? All right, there we go. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. I declare this month is a month of unstoppable blessings. From October 1st to the 31st, I declare the supernatural favor of heaven will manifest over my life. I declare supernatural protection wherever I go. I declare hundredfold restoration of things I have lost in Jesus' name. I declare north, south, east, west, the goodness of God will locate me and my family. I cancel every plan of the enemy by the blood of Jesus that has been formed against me in this month of October in Jesus' name. I declare that whatever I put my hands to shall prosper by the blood of Jesus. I declare this month will be a month of open heavens in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Give the Lord the best clap offering in this place. Hallelujah. Amen. Last service, I was so excited when sister came up and she has written it down so nicely of the testimonies. She said during her prayer that they were praying and believing God for a grandson, and God has given them a beautiful baby boy. A second thing is that she prayed that God prayed for a place. They were believing God for a place, and God has given them a place in Vijayawada. Third thing is that they were praying for a house, and God has blessed them abundantly and gifted them a house in Ramuthi Nagar. Wow. And last thing they said is, we lost our bike, and we were praying. After 3 months, God returned the same bike that was lost to them and this family in the name of Jesus. Come on, give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. FJG, lift your hand in this place. Father, we pray, we decree and declare that supernatural testimonies will locate your children, oh God, in Jesus' mighty name. Every person in this place, Lord, even as we have decreed and declared, we believe that in the month of October, Lord, let testimonies find them, north, south, east, west, by the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Somebody say, I receive it. In the name of Jesus Christ, hallelujah. We praise and thank God for all that He's doing, church. I want to encourage everybody, please make sure Fridays you spend some time to come to church, whether it's in Kannur or Indranagar. We've been having a wonderful time evenings right here for our 90 minutes with Jesus. Last week, my sister was calling out names, and she called out this person named Danush. And after the service, the person had actually sent her a message saying, my name is Danush, and when you call my name out, he had tears in his eyes, and at that very moment, God had given him his miracle. So we have been having a great time from the time we started our prophetic healing service. Every Friday is getting better and better in the name of Jesus. So if you have time, please come out, because it's just been an awesome time soaking in the presence of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 2 weeks back, we spoke about the Passover. Last week, we spoke about the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, and today we're going to be talking about the Feast of the First Fruits. Like I told you, everything in the Bible points to Jesus. Everything in the Bible points to what Jesus has done for us on the cross of Calvary. I always tell people, every Sunday evenings, my dad and I, we get together and we talk about the day, we talk about the services, we talk about the sermons that we preach, and we share each other's revelations. And I was telling him, Dad, I have decided in my heart that till my last breath, there's only one message I'm going to preach, and that is Christ crucified on the cross. Because there is something powerful released when every believer takes your eyes off yourself and focuses on Jesus and what He has done on the cross of Calvary. Like I told you, I spend time studying the Word, and everything in the Bible, there is significance to everything. Can somebody tell me whom were the three people who were closest to Jesus? Can somebody tell me that? Who was the closest to Jesus among His disciples? We see that there was Peter, James, and John. But when you put these names together, you get something so interesting. The name Peter means, everybody knows, the Peter means Peter means stone and it's pointing to the Ten Commandments. James means to exchange, and John means God's grace and love. When you put all of this together, this is what it means. When you put all of it together, it means the law was exchanged by God's grace and love through who? Through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. What are the first four books of the New Testament? Can anybody tell me? Everybody knows this. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Very good. When you study the names of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, this is what you get. Matthew means given or a reward. The word Mark, the name Mark means to shine. Luke means revelation or illumination. And John means God's grace and love. When you put all of it together, this is what you get. God's gift and reward is that we will shine through the revelation of God's love and grace. Hallelujah. My friend, everything in the Bible, listen, this is not something I just made up. But everything in the Bible points to what Jesus has done for us on the cross of Calvary. Hallelujah. When I was reading Matthew 27, everybody knows the story. When it came for time for Jesus to be judged, we see that there was Barabbas and there was Jesus. And every year they had a chance to choose whom they were going to let go free. We see Barabbas was standing there. Barabbas was guilty. Barabbas was a rebel. Barabbas was a murderer. But when we see Jesus, Jesus is so loving. Jesus is kind. Wherever Jesus went, the Bible says that he healed people. He provided for people. He set people free. He sent demons packing. But when it came time to choose, they chose the murderer. The murderer would go free, and that was Barabbas. They chose the guilty one would go free. My friend, when you look at this story, the name Barabbas means son of my father. We see that he went free. That means it was pointing to us. We were guilty. We deserved the stripes. We deserved the piercing. We deserved all the judgment. But instead of us taking it, Jesus said he is going to take it for us on the cross of Calvary. So now there was a divine exchange. The innocent one went on behalf of us. And because of the death and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ today, all of us are sons and daughters of our Heavenly Father. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Today we are not beggars, but we are children of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Can somebody shout a good amen in this place? Everybody lift your hand in this place. Open your mouth and say, I am not a beggar. I am a child of God. One more time. I am not a beggar, but I am a child of God. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. All right, quickly, let's continue into the feast. I'm so excited about today. Leviticus 23. Leviticus 23. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when ye be come into the land which I give unto you and shall reap the harvest thereof, then ye shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits. Somebody say first fruits. First fruits of your harvest unto the priest, and he shall wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted for you. On the morrow after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it, and he shall offer that day when he waved the sheaf and he lamb without blemish of the first year for a burnt offering unto the Lord, and the meat offering thereof shall be 2/10 deals of fine flour mingled with oil, an offering made by fire unto the Lord for a sweet savor, and the drink offering thereof shall be of wine the fourth part of an hin. And he shall eat neither bread nor parched corn nor green ears until the selfsame day that he have brought an offering unto your God. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings. All right. Now this is such a beautiful feast. Now what would happen is, I want everybody to please focus on me. So what the priest would do is, he would go to the field where the harvest is. And when he goes to the field, there is a great excitement. There is great rejoicing. This is none like anything else, all right? So when they are going to the field, all the children of Israel would follow the high priest with singing, with dancing, with shouting. Come on, somebody. Everybody's walking down to the harvest field. Oh, that is great celebration. Oh, it's a time of rejoicing. It's a time of dancing. Why? Because now, once the priest goes to the field, he is going to select 10% of that field. So the first fruit offering, he is going to collect it. Remember this one thing. Nobody else is allowed to touch the first fruit offering. Only the priest is allowed to do it. All right? So when he goes, he takes the first fruit offering, and now he's bringing it. And again, as he's going back, again, people are celebrating. Come on, team. People are celebrating. People are shouting. People are giving thanks to God, because this is awesome. Now, once he gets to the temple, thank you, guys. Once he gets to the temple, this is where it gets very serious. Everyone, look at me and listen to me. This is where it gets very serious. Because at this point of time, the priest is to wave the offering in front of God as a dedication. Now, everybody is waiting. Everybody is in a bit. Everybody's a little bit scared. They're anxious. Because if God doesn't receive the first fruit offering, all the remainder of the harvest is going to be burnt and thrown away. All the harvest becomes useless, and they cannot even go and touch it. It has to be burnt. But the moment the priest goes and stands and he waves the offering in front of God, and the moment he gets the sign that God has accepted the first fruit offering, now again, all the children of Israel, they are rejoicing. They are shouting. They are dancing. Why? Just because God accepted the first fruit, now the remainder of the 90% of the harvest is accepted to God, and it can be used. It will never be rejected. Why? Because God has accepted the first fruit offering. All right? Now, everybody got that. That is so cool, because I'll tell you why. Because the same time, Ashwin, come here. The same time, all right? Everyone, please look at me. Do not miss this revelation. Now say, Ashwin is the high priest. The same time that the priest is waving the first fruit offering to God is the same time Jesus is walking out of the grave. All right? Now wait. Don't clap. All right? Jesus is walking out of the grave. Who is the first person to greet Jesus when he walks out of the grave? Who is the first person when he's walking? There's one woman who comes up to him, and what does she do? She goes up to Jesus to hug him. She goes to hug him. But what does Jesus say? I always wondered, have any of you ever wondered when you read that portion of scripture, why was Jesus so mean to Mary? After all, she was excited, right? She was so happy that Jesus has resurrected. I would be the same way. When I see Jesus, I'm like, Jesus! I myself would go running to hug him, jump on him. Oh my gosh, you're back. But he looked at Mary, and look at what he said. John 20, verse 17. Jesus said unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and... Okay, let's read that again. I ascend unto my Father and your Father, unto my God and your... Your God. Very good. Now go to 1 Corinthians 15. All right? 1 Corinthians 15. But everybody read with me. 1, 2, 3. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since... Don't stop reading. Come on, church. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. Next scripture. For as in Adam all... Even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Next scripture. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming.
Then come at the end when he shall have delivered up the kingdom of God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule, all authority and power. Now listen to me, everybody, look at me please. Now the same time the priest is waving the first fruit offering to God, Jesus was on his way to heaven, but he saw Mary in a brokenness and he went to meet Mary. When he met Mary, Mary hugged him. He said, Mary, do not touch me. The same way nobody was allowed to touch the first fruit, Jesus told Mary, do not touch the first fruit. Why? Because I have not yet ascended to my Father. When Jesus went up to the Father, here on earth, they are waving the first fruit offering, and there in heaven, Jesus is saying, I am your first fruit offering. In other words, because God has accepted Jesus, now all of us are accepted into the family of God. All of us are accepted into the kingdom of God. All of us are established. We have been transferred from the dominion of darkness into the dominion of light, which is who? Which is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Because nowadays, people, remember this one thing. The devil will always come to you and tell you, you know why you didn't receive your breakthrough? Because there is something wrong about you. You know why you didn't receive your healing and they did? Because you are not good enough. You know why you're not getting that increase? It is because you have been rejected by God. But remember, who is your first fruits? Jesus is your first fruits. And because he has been accepted by the Father, all the harvest. You know who the harvest is? The harvest is every believer, that they will never be rejected by God. They will never, God will never push them away. Why? Because if the first fruit was accepted, all of us are accepted into the dominion of light, which is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Shatamaralaba. And he'll always come in first person, the devil. You're not good enough. You're worthless. Nothing will ever happen. But remember, if your first fruit has been accepted, and that is Jesus, you are also accepted into the beloved of Jesus Christ. Can I ask you something, church, this morning? Will God ever reject Jesus? Come on. Will God ever reject Jesus? Say it with conviction. Will God ever reject Jesus? No, he will never reject Jesus. If he never rejects Jesus, then he will never reject you. Hey, yeah, yeah. Now listen. Oh, okay. Romans 11, 16. My prayers, you get this, okay? Everybody, look up at the screen and read with me. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. For if the first fruit be holy, and if the root be holy, so are the... 1 minute. Holiness is not the root. Holiness is the fruit. Jesus is your root. That's the beauty. Because if you put it on yourself, I promise you, you will always fail. And that's what now, there are many ministries. They only focus on you. What are you doing? Why are you not doing this? You should do. Do, do, do. That was under the law. You had to do to receive. Do to receive. But under the new covenant of Jesus, you believe and you rest in what Jesus has done, and the supply is continuously being supplied to you. Because holiness is not a struggle when you know that holiness comes from a person. And now the person is living where? Inside of you. Has anybody ever here, please tell me, okay, if you've seen it, let me know. I want to go see that too. Has anybody here seen an apple tree and the apple is struggling to grow? Anybody? When you go to the apple tree, the apple looks at you and says, Machi, please help me grow now. I'm not able to receive everything. Please do something so I can grow. Has anyone ever seen that kind of tree? No. Has anyone ever seen a coconut tree struggling? No. Has anyone ever seen a banana tree struggling? No, then why are believers still struggling? Let this sit. Let it sit. Because remember, everything you need to be a successful Christian, you are already connected to the source. You are already connected to the supply, and His name is Jesus. Because remember, when God came into your life, He didn't come in percentage. He didn't say, okay, Brother Murthy, I will come 20%. Pastor Derek, I will come 30%. Sagar, minus 30%, you still have a long way to go. He didn't say that. But when you receive Jesus, He didn't come in percentage. He came in the fullness of God to live inside of you. That is the beauty of resting in the finished work. Because nowadays, I listen to people praying. I listen to their prayer. Because when I listen to the prayer, I know where they are in their revelation and who they are in Jesus. Because you'll always hear people pray, Lord, please, Lord, give us your power. Lord, please, Lord, give us your anointing. Lord, please, Lord, give us your goodness. It's like as if we don't know what Jesus has done. But God is saying, hey, listen to me. You are the branch. I am the vine. I will continuously give you the power, the anointing, the goodness, the favor. The grace that you need to be a success in life is not flowing because of what you have done, is flowing because of who you are connected to. And forever, church, you are connected to the best supplier, and His name is Jesus. His power will never go dry. His anointing will never go empty. His grace and favor will never fail. His wisdom will never grow cold. But every day of your life, the supplier is continuously coming into you are the branch, and you will effortlessly bear fruit in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That is who we are. This is who we are. Always believers, why do we pray from a lack-minded position? When we are connected to the source and the supply of heaven. No, I'm asking. Think, everybody, please. It's not only for you. I'm preaching to myself. Because when I receive these revelations, I'm so excited about, you know who? I'm excited about Jesus. Because now everything of me, I find in Him. When you take a walk outside as a family, when you're taking a drive, just look at the trees. Look at the trees and say, wow, some of the trees. When you go to MG Road, have you seen those trees? I love MG Road. Reminds me of old Bangalore. When you go there, all the trees are nicely covering the whole road. Am I right? And if you grew up in Bangalore, it reminds you of old Bangalore. Am I right? It's so beautiful. Take a moment to look down at the bottom of the tree. Because it's so big. And you know that all the leaves are so green. It is because of the vine that is continuously supplying to the branches. Today, Jesus is saying, why are you struggling in your supply when you're connected to the vine that is me? Why are you struggling for power when you are connected to me? Businessmen, I want to encourage you. Why are you struggling for wisdom and ideas when you are connected to the source of wisdom, and that is Jesus Christ? Listen, wait. This is the simplicity of the gospel, which believers have made complicated. Am I right? Because we always run around. What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? No, it's not what you should do. It's about you resting and knowing who you are connected to. Because when you pray, as you're praying, you know, nowadays when I pray, I never ask. I decree and I declare, because I know who I am connected to. I'm not saying that boastfully, but it took time for me to get there. Believer, you are connected to the vine, and the vine is connected to who? Connected to you, so you will effortlessly bear fruit in the name of Jesus Christ. Because we all think, oh, today I operate in 20% power. Tomorrow I operate in 30% anointing. Tomorrow I will operate in 40% favor and grace. But God is saying, no. All those things I just mentioned is found in a person. And that person's GPS location is right there on the inside of you. So now when you pray, pray with excitement. God, I release your supply right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you where I go. I thank you that your favor, your grace, your power, your anointing is already moving through my life in the name of Jesus. Now there is an excitement when I pray. You know why? Because I'm not praying that I'm incomplete. I'm praying because I have been made complete in Jesus Christ. Challenge you. How many businessmen we have here? Lift your hand. So many. Okay. So many of y'all. When you pray this week, I want to challenge you. Romans 11:16. Uncle JK. All of y'all. Romans 11:16. Everybody else too. Use this scripture and pray. If I am connected to the source of wisdom and ideas, why are people getting those ideas before the believer? When the one who created the heavens and the earth is living right here on the inside of me. This week, I challenge you, church. One scripture, Romans 11:16. Meditate on the scripture for the week and see what God will do for you. I'm telling you, take off the complications and just rest in Jesus Christ. That's the beauty of the gospel. Look at what Colossians 2:9-10 says, and then we're going to pray after this. For, everyone read with me, for in him dwelleth. Okay, one more time, slowly. Ready? 1, 2, 3. For in him dwelleth. Okay, who is the him it's talking about? It's talking about Jesus. All, some of the fullness of God? Little of the fullness of God? All the fullness of God. Read. 1, 2, 3. And 1 minute. Which is the head of all? One more time, read that. Which is the head of all? And you are? Who's it talking about? You. The fullness of God dwells in Jesus. And you are complete, you know why? Because it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. You are not an incomplete person. You are a complete person. It is because of Jesus who is living on the inside of you. Hey, 1 minute, 1 minute. And he is the head of some demons, some devil. No, of all power, all principality. If he is above every power and principality, you are also above every power and principality. If every power, if every demon, if every devil is under his feet, guess what? It is also under your feet in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hey, wow. And that is the beauty of looking to Jesus. I want to encourage everyone. I challenge you, please. This week, even if you take 5 minutes with Romans 11:16, when you close your eyes, family time, night times, when you come together as a family to pray, just close your eyes. Romans 11:16. Hold hands together. Father, right now we speak your supply into our situation. I pray that you will manifest your supply into our situation. I pray, Lord, you will manifest your glory in this situation. Because you know what? It's all rightfully yours through the wonderful work of Jesus Christ. Remember, if he is accepted, he will never be rejected from the Father. Today, you are also accepted in the beloved, Ephesians 1, and you will never be rejected by the Father. If any condemning voice comes and tell you, if any believer themselves comes and tells you, remember this, he is your first fruits. If he was accepted, you are forever accepted by the Father. He will never ever reject you, church. He will always, 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 he will be with you till the very end. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen and amen. Stand with me and let's pray. Now may the grace of our Lord, the love of the Father, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit continue to rest and abide with us, even as we go out knowing that we are forever connected to the vine. We are forever accepted by God. It is not because of what we have done. It is because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross of Calvary. In Jesus' mighty name, and everybody said, amen. Can we give God a good clap offering in this place? Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Are you blessed this morning, church?
Subscribe to FGAG's official YouTube channel. All you need to do is just head over to our channel and click on the subscribe button. You can also follow us on Facebook on Reverend Paul Thangaya and Reverend Sammy Thangaya's page. You will receive all the latest updates of our services, events, and how hearts and souls are being touched around the globe.